When it comes to why we spend our time here together looking into the microcosmos, I'm sure we all have our own reasons. Maybe the mysteries of the algorithm lured you here. Maybe you just like peering into a world that feels so distant from our own, that feels full of creatures so different from us. But just how different are they? We're focusing today on a journey to the microcosmos favorite, the ciliates, the single-celled eukaryotes covered in hair-like structures called cilia. In our last episode, we ventured into the murky depths of ciliate history and what our studies on them have taught us about, well, you know, them. Today, we thought we'd be a little more self-centered and explore what ciliates have taught us about ourselves. Of course, just looking at ciliates, it's hard to find much of a resemblance to us. To start, they're made up of just one cell, able to carry out all their needs with the organelles packed into the confines of one membrane. We, on the other hand, start out as a single cell, but that single cell must divide over and over so that the trillions and trillions of cells it eventually forms can cohere into different structures that become a body. Ciliates also have reproduction options available to them that we do not, like asexual reproduction where one cell can divide and produce a clone of itself. And as we talked about in our last video, some ciliates also have two different types of nuclei, and during reproduction, those different nuclei go through their own complicated process to form the creation of the new ciliate, a process that certainly does set them apart from us. So where are some of our similarities? You might think, sure, there are different features, but at the end of the day, we all have the same DNA. And it is remarkable to look across nature and remember that we are all built out of a common code, a shared path from DNA to protein. Except, ciliates throw a wrench in that seemingly fundamental similarity too. Many ciliate species, including Paramecium, Blepharisma, and Euplodes, use certain parts of their genetic code differently from us, deviating from the norms that are so common to so many organisms. So if we can differ so fundamentally from so many ciliates, how is it that they have anything to teach us about ourselves? Well, for one, we share a home, which means that we're always crossing paths with ciliates, even when we don't realize it. Our lives are built on ecosystems that they help lay the groundwork for, whether that's through photosynthesis, or contributing to the food web, or breaking down dead stuff, or something else. So learning more about ciliates helps us better understand the way our own home functions. But ciliates don't just intersect with us. Watching them also reveals the way they parallel us. And who better to explain this than our own master of microscopes, James, who has dedicated so much of his life to watching ciliates.
Ciliates are just single cells, but they behave like multicellular animals. They react to things, and watching them kind of makes you think about free will. Because everything I am feeling is also a reaction to a chemical compound in my body. Getting this chance to witness life in a very pure, cellular level just made me develop this healthier habit of trying to understand myself better.
What James is describing is in line with a whole history of ciliate research, where our ability to watch and study these small creatures enables us to better understand the tiny, invisible parts of ourselves. For example, scientists have been studying the way that Paramecium swim for more than a century, and in the 1970s, these scientists reported that the movement of Paramecium was controlled in part by calcium ions that traveled across the organism's membrane and into the cell. Eventually, some of the same mechanisms and molecules involved in that behavior were found to be controlling the activity of neurons, transporting a pathway found in ciliates to more complex creatures. Another ciliate, Tetrahymena, has also made its own mark in our understanding of ourselves. You may have heard of telomeres. These are protective caps at the end of our chromosomes made from repeated DNA sequences that help ensure the essential DNA does not get lost during DNA replication. With every replication, the telomeres get shorter and shorter. Eventually, they are too short for the cell to survive. Our first understanding of telomeres came in the 1930s from two scientists who were not working on microbes. One was Herman Muller, who was observing fruit flies, and the other was Barbara McClintock, who was studying maize. Over the next few decades, scientists were able to expand their understanding of telomeres and DNA in general, but techniques to work with DNA were still quite limited compared to the resources scientists have available to them now. So one of the main challenges in studying telomeres was working with the sheer length of the DNA that is found in eukaryotes. But when they realized tetrahymena contained numerous mini-chromosomes, they also realized they had the material to more readily study how telomeres work. And they even found that the tetrahymena telomeres worked in yeast cells too, suggesting that there was something about telomeres that seemed to be shared by a number of species. The work in tetrahymena also helped scientists find the enzyme that maintains telomeres, which is called telomerase. There are so many aspects of this work that could make it seem like it's just one of those fun ciliate traits that scientists uncover. It's a funny little cap on their chromosomes. What could it possibly have to do with us? Well, if you've heard of telomeres, then you probably know the answer. Our chromosomes have telomeres, and scientists eventually realized that because of their rapid replication, cancerous cells have shorter telomeres than non-cancerous cells. So to survive, these cells often evolve to have more active telomerase enzymes. In a 2006 paper detailing the history of telomere research, the scientists instrumental to their discovery described the work as, quote, pure curiosity-driven research. They did not set out to uncover a mechanism that lay at the center of how cancers operate and might possibly be treated. They just wanted to look at something cool they found in a ciliate. It's hard to know exactly what we want to make of that. On the one hand, it is incredible to look at ciliates and think, wow, they helped us understand how cancers work. But on the other hand, it's hard to escape this presumption that can accompany that sort of statement, that we need some kind of justification for curiosity beyond just the curiosity itself. But maybe that's the whole point, that there is no curiosity of its own. Curiosity always exists in the context of what drives it and what it's made of. Just like James said, everything I feel is just a reaction to a chemical inside of my body. We're just lucky enough to have evolved curiosity. And we evolved it because it gave us advantages. And so when we are curious, we should not be surprised when it delivers results. And that definitely does not lessen my appreciation for it as one of the very finest qualities of humanity. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. The people on the screen right now are our Patreon patrons. They are also people who, I'm pretty sure, are chasing their curiosity. Thank you so much to everybody who has ever supported this channel. And if you want to join up for at least the last little bits of this channel existing, because we are going to stop making videos soon, you can do that at patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, please go explore our archive. There is so much good stuff on this channel.